What's it for?
The same stuff that you already have.
Capital program.
Okay.
Mayor, you ready?
I'm ready.
Ellen?
Yes.
Ready, good?
Yes.
Let's go. Council agenda, Township Parsippany Troy Hills, regular Township Council meeting of June 21st, 2016. The time is approximately 7:33 PM.
Posting of notice, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in accordance with the requirements of the Open Public Meetings Law by filing the notice in the office of the Township Clerk and by posting the meeting notice on the bulletin board at the municipal building on December 17th, 2015, where it has remained posted since that date. A legal notice appeared in the Daily Record on December 22nd, 2015, and the Newark Star Ledger on December 24th, 2015, and was forwarded by fax to the local newspapers and local radio stations on December 17th, 2015. Note, council meetings are videotaped and aired on Cablevision Public Access Channel 21 at 11 o'clock a.m. on Sundays and are also available for viewing at www.parsippany.net.
Please stand for a flag salute. Mr. Creefy.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
Mr. Carriffy?
Here.
Mr. DePiro?
Here.
Ms. Grignani?
Present.
Mr. Peluso?
Present.
Mr. Valori?
Present.
Also in attendance are Mayor James Barbario, Business Administrator Ellen Sandman, the CFO Ann Cucci, the Township Clerk Colette Madden, and the Board Attorney Owen Weaver. Mr. President, we have a quorum. You may begin.
Thank you. The upcoming meetings will be July 5th at 7:30. That will be our agenda meeting. And the next one beyond that would be July 19th at 7:30. That will be our regular meeting. Approval of the minutes were on May 24th, 2016. And next we'll have presentations and reports. And Mayor, I know you have a lot of...
Well, we'll have Senator Panaccio.
Great.
Senator here?
Senator Panaccio's in the back there.
Thank you.
Would Assemblywoman DeCroche?
Yep.
If you could please come forward.
Can we postpone that then?
Well, no, they're going to do the...
Mr. Jurgensen's right there.
Yeah.
Oh. There he is.
Yes. Does he know the order?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
If not, then,
all right.
I'll take it.
All right. Thank you. Yeah, I did too.
Works. You can hear me now.
It works.
I married the both of you. I forgot about that.
So,
you want to start? You're the senator. All right, go ahead, Senator.
Charles, tonight we want to just take a few minutes because you took a few decades to do what you did. I don't think I've ever heard your name mentioned and then something good said right after it. Too many years with Morris County as the veterans coordinator. The proclamation, which I will not read, says that you've helped over 17,000 veterans. The old adage about helping in one person, if I can paraphrase, you change the world. Well, you've changed too many worlds, and the 17,000 is underestimate, because I know we worked on the Morris County Service Medal, and last I saw there were, 10,000, 11,000? So tack on another 10 or 11,000 to the 17,000. Because they count too. So for all the good things that you did, we just want to take a minute or two and just publicly thank you for all the public work that you've done and for all the good help that you've done, the good work that you've done for our veterans. No other group deserves as much recognition as our veterans do. We don't do enough, but not because of your fault. Thank you, Kels.
I'm not going to read this either, Mr. Jurgensen. I'm sure you don't want to. Everyone, it's an absolutely nice resolution from the State Assembly, and we truly are indebted to our veterans, and especially to you from Morris County. And I'm sure my late husband knew you, and Alex was a freeholder and a director, so we felt it was appropriate to do this here in Parsippany and to give you this proclamation. So we thank you for your service so much, and your family for being there, you know, with you, and not only that, you know, being in the service and coming back is, you know, something that we all are thankful for. And today I was at the library over in Lake Hiawatha, and it was a reading, and it was Franklin Delano Roosevelt, that he was given the story, and we were talking about World War II, and I did mention that my uncles were in, all four of them from Parsippany Road, were in the military, and they were in World War II in the Korean War, and I said how lucky we are that they all came home, because many, that does not happen. So we thank you for being there and helping the ones that have suffered in pain, and also for memories that, you know, make it hard for them. So we thank you for your help.
Thank you.
I'm going to read.
All right. But I'd like the council to come up with me.
All right, great. On this reading.
Because you get to know what this gentleman has done for Morris County and for Parsippany as well. The Township of Parsippany Troy Hills Proclamation, whereas he retires, it is a great honor and personal pleasure to pay tribute to Charles Jorgensen, a man profound dedication who since 2003 has honorably served as a veteran service coordinator for the Morris County Department of Human Services, and whereas a former Marine who served in the 2nd Marine Division in the late 1950s, Charles Jorgensen understands firsthand the meaning of sacrifice and efforts made by all veterans to safeguard our freedoms. And whereas for the past 13 years, Charles Jorgensen has assisted Morris County veterans ensuring that they receive benefits to which they were entitled while providing them with the well-earned respect and admiration. And whereas due to a tremendous work ethic throughout the years and a sincere devotion to helping veterans, Charles Jorgensen was the recipient of the Unsung Hero Service Award in 2015 for his longtime dedication to the needs of military veterans and their families in Morris County. And whereas the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills owes a bit of gratitude to Charles Jorgensen for the many flags he provided over the years for our veterans' ceremonies. All those flags that you see, it's from Charles. Thank you, Charles. Whereas Charles Jorgensen has set the standard and has raised the bar with his integrity, accountability, honesty, and professionalism, earning the respect and confidence of people we serve. Now therefore, I, James R. Barbera, the mayor of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills, do hereby proclaim June 21st, 2016 as Charles Jorgensen Day, and take this opportunity to express sincere appreciation for the manner in which he performed his duties with gratitude for his professionalism, dedication to service, and warm, friendly demeanor. I further acknowledge that Charles Jorgensen will be missed both personally and professionally, and extend best wishes for continued success, happiness, and good health in his retirement. I have something for you from the Township of Parsippany. Since you've given us so many flags, this is for you. But I have to say, last Tuesday I celebrated Flag Day, and my father was a World War II veteran who was in five major campaigns during the war. And I have to tell you, I will never forget how much my father loved this flag. His parents were immigrants from Italy, but this was his first love. This is what he loved. He loved this country. He defended this country. And if it wasn't for gentlemen like you, my father, and all the veterans that serve us past and present, we would not be standing here today. So, Charles, as a gift, you can fly this high, and that is the greatest flag in the world. So,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
You know, I will say that I've never been honored like this. I am truly appreciative of what you folks have done for me this evening. I was a VSO for the last 13 years, Veteran Service Officer. One of my last accomplishments was to hire or to bring on for our memorial service for Memorial Day, Lieutenant Kroot, who's a national recruiter for the military. I wanted to bring him on because I want young people to know and their parents to know what the military can do for them today. And I think that that conference went very well. I'm appreciative of that. I think service is something we've got to give back to our country today. We've forgotten about that. This flag means an awful lot to me also. I was not a combat vet. However, I dealt with combat vets for the last 13 years, one of which is sitting over there, Bob Ryback, a Vietnam veteran, well-decorated, with valor, and he happened to just show up. He heard about me being awarded this award tonight, and he came to award it to be with me tonight. I am truly honored by this flag, by the way, Mr. Mayor. Lou Valori, nice to see you again.
Same here.
Thank you very much, all of you. Senator, thank you. Thank you.
Good to see you again.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Greg is not here yet, I don't believe.
He's right here.
He is? He came in? Okay.
Yeah. Senator, if you could come forward.
So, come on up. Come on up. So we're very honored to be here this evening to present all these certificates for the marching band winning their state championship. And as legislators that represent Parsippany, and I live in Parsippany, we're just very proud and very honored. And we really would love to invite them down to the State House and do a really official presentation there as well. So if we can all work that out with the school, that's something that we would be very proud of, because other communities within the state do, and we would just love to have Parsippany down there.
Sure.
So we congratulate you for all work
you.
In the marching band, and for them being a tremendous asset to the country.
Well, I was never in a high school marching band, but what happened, I played the trombone in junior high school, and then I went to high school and I saw all the pretty cheerleaders, and I said I'd rather play football. In hindsight, I should have stuck with the trombone. But having said that, this is a big deal. This is a real big deal. This is something that that the kids that you mentored, I don't know how many are in the room now and their parents, you will never forget this. This will stay with you for the rest of your life. So, and I just have very fond memories of, not too fond memories of high school and football and things like that. But the friendships that you develop, that's a big deal too. And we can thank, besides thanking the leader, we also have to thank the parents that slept you there back and forth. That word when you didn't come home on time, and that were there biting the nails and worrying about what place you would come in as far as the competition. But regardless where you came in that competition, you gave it your all. We're so very, very proud of you. Thank you. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
You want to have a... hold one of them up.
Yeah,
hold one of them up.
Oh, okay.
Thank you, Senator.
Happy Fourth.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Right, thank you. These are all
right.
We kept them straight, so.
We have one other presentation. That'll be Councilman Peluso.
Senator Panaccio and Assemblywoman DeCrosse, if you could please stay for this as well, we appreciate it. Thank you very much. If I can also ask the entire council and mayor to join me in front, please.
Great.
I But I asked everybody to join me today because we have a very special presentation as well. We have a celebration of a coach and teacher and a marching band, and we appreciate all your efforts. But there's additional efforts in the school system that we'd like to recognize as well. In March, a normal day for our students was an everyday routine, but we had one of our students, his name was Noah, and he attended Central Junior High School. And on that day, he went to gym class, like our normal students do. He excused himself from his class, and he went to the restroom. Upon entering, several students, we would like to congratulate and thank all the students that participated in that. And when we have all their names, we will honor them as well. But they were alarmed because one of our fellow students was in distress. They alerted our gym teacher, and our gym teacher, phys ed teacher today they called, and they actually came to the rescue and performed CPR on the student. In performing CPR on the student, they also alerted our school nurse in Central Junior High School. And the nurse also responded and applied the AED, and they both assisted in revitalizing our student, our neighbor, Noah. And one of the things that is unsaid is that I had a chance to speak with the phys ed gym teacher, and he's new to our school system. Matter of fact, he recently graduated from college, and this is his first job working within the school system and performing an excellent job as well. We have a seasoned nurse that was there to support the efforts as well. And one of the things I'd like to say is, thanks to their gallant efforts, we have Noah with us today. I'd also like to say that their parents are here today, Noah's parents, Jennifer and Tim, who are equally appreciative of all the efforts. And sometimes it's about winning awards, but a lot of times it's about the honor and the quick actions of people that save lives. So we all stand here today to really thank these two individuals. And I'd like to ask the first individual to join us, which is Esteban Morales. Esteban, great job. And a certificate of appreciation from the council and our administration is for his quick response to providing medical attention in an emergency situation. Say a couple of words? He'd like to say a couple of words.
Oh, thank you.
Congratulations.
Thanks everyone for coming here tonight. It's amazing to see Noah's parents here, Jennifer and Tim. And tonight just means everything because Noah's home. Well, you guys, the family's together, and he's in recovery. That's all. That's the most anyone can ask for. And we have Jared Schwed here, who stood right next to me. I remember, like, it happens, like, things like this happen really fast. And Jared was there the entire time. He's either seen this before, but he was super calm. And I just remember he's the one who, helped keep me calm. Dan Lupo's here. Theo couldn't make it, but when you have students, it's crazy. You always have students who have to ask to go permission to go to the bathroom. And that day, they just went to the bathroom, which is, you know, thank goodness for that, but they went and they heard something, but they spoke. Something, you know, you could have just gone in and just been like, oh, like someone's, you know, just in the bathroom, but they knew something was wrong and they spoke up. So when you have awesome students that speak up for their classmates, and you have Barbara Bailey, and then you have everyone who's, you know, responding, the EMS team that we have in this town, and everyone from Mr. Gray, we have Evan Totka, and Joseph Flanagan, and you know, just the whole team that just gets together, and everyone responded the way they needed to, from getting on their walkies to calling who we needed, and it just was perfect timing. So it was a team effort, and now we have Noah and a family that's together. So that I just think it represents this town. It's an amazing town to work for, and just happy that everyone's here tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. We'd also like to invite Barbara Bailey up. Barbara is our RN for our school, our nurse, and for her quick response to providing medical attention in an emergency situation, our debt of gratitude goes out to you. Thank you so much. Should I say a couple words?
No.
Okay.
No,
say thank you.
You know what? All the kids at Central Middle School are my kids from the first time they walked through the door, and I would do everything and anything for my children. So Noah's mine, and he will be mine forever, just as much as all the kids I've had for the last 16 years. So.
Well, thank you again for your efforts, and also I'd like to thank the Emergency Medical Squad for our township for the fine work that they do in our community. And I'd also like to ask the parents to come up here because they've asked to say a couple of words.
Thank you. So on March 3rd, we got a phone call that was devastating. Our son was in an accident. We had no idea what was going on. We arrived at the emergency room in a panic, and we really found that something severe happened. And it was devastating for us. We had no idea how severe his injury was. And a 13-year-old kid suffering a cardiac arrest is almost unheard of. We are a family, we have a strong faith, and we believe that God had sent some angels to be by his side, because if it wasn't for that, he would have taken him from us, and he didn't, because there was angels there to protect him that day, and he's here with us today for that very reason. So we're ever grateful for that. We know that today, I'm happy to report that Noah is progressing. So he's making progress. He's not where he needs to be, and the type of injury he has is something that's going to take a long time. It's not days, it's months. However, if we look back from where we were to where we are today, there's progress. And that's the most important thing. We're hopeful that we can get him home someday. Not there yet, but he's in a rehab facility and he has the right people taking care of him. The one thing I wanted to mention, though, is when we were in the emergency room in Morristown, they said, the doctors were like, whoever took care of him did everything right. They did everything perfectly. And for that, we're so grateful, because the steps were taken, the boys were there to help and support, and that means a ton. The fact that they were looking out for Noah and for his best interests. So today we have hope. And then as we look forward, we have a lot of hope that he's gonna come back. He's gonna be that same kid that played on the DeCroce's Dodgers years ago, okay, that I coached that team. He's going to be the same kid shooting hoops in the driveway again. It's not today, and maybe a year from now we'll see that, and that's what we're hoping for. So this is a great honor, Robert, for putting this together. This is to recognize the folks that are doing the great things in town, as well as the EMTs who did a great job transporting him. He's in the right place right now, and he's going to get home. When that is, we don't know yet, but we're just going to keep praying that he'll continue and be back. So thank you. Thank you, everybody, for coming tonight. It means the world to us. Thanks.
We just ask if you can pray for Noah. He appreciates all the prayers, and the family does as well. So thank you very much to the family, and we wish him the best. Thank you.
This guy can eat wings that are hot, I gotta tell you.
We'll have to have a challenge here. That's it. Before we move on with township business, I'm gonna give you all the opportunity if you want to escape now. So I'll give you a few minutes to get up, don't be embarrassed. And I'm sure you'll really be happy to hear about all these ordinances in place. Thank you. We appreciate you coming tonight. Thank you. Nellie, you're not going nowhere. Great job. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a good one.
Thank you.
Great job.
real excited about our budget.
It's a good thing I had tissues with me.
Okay. We're going to move forward. I had you next as business administrator. Yes, we could do that. Absolutely. Ellen, I have you on a timer also.
Thank you.
All right, next, before we move forward, we're going to have our business administrator, Ellen Sandman, present some issues that are going to be discussed tonight.
One of the things... One of the things that we talked about at the budget meeting was to go over some of the concerns, and we did introduce the budget at the last meeting, but in conversation with the council president, I said one of the things we didn't get to address was the capital issue with regard to the Belgian block that has to do with North Beverwijk. In deference to the council in trying to get to them the best information that they can have, we did two things. One, we asked our engineer to come out to answer any of the questions, and perhaps before he answers some questions, Ann and I and Justin had a conversation about just to set the stage as to what we're talking about and what are the numbers. That being said, what we also did was, so we can move forward with all the things that need to be accomplished, going forward with the introduction of the capital ordinances, we have provided two for this evening. One that would contain the amount of money in the overall ordinance for the inclusion of the Belgian block, and then another one if the vote does not carry with a majority of the council. So that being said, I don't think there's anything more to say, but just to, if it's okay with the council president, to turn it over to Justin.
Absolutely.
Come forward and then describe the project as it is, and then the discussion as it relates to the inclusion of and what it would take to include the Belgian block.
Good evening. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Justin.
Just to provide some clarification, North Beverwijk Road, as you all know, is in need of repair. We applied for a grant through the New Jersey Department of Transportation last year, and we had received $245,000 as a grant, or we were awarded that much. The project itself actually was a lot larger than where we are now. Originally, it was supposed to be from Route 46 to Lakeshore Drive. But in discussions that I've had with the mayor over the last several months, we decided to cut out the business area under this part of the grant. The worst part of the road really is the area by Surdell and Route 46. So we wanted to make sure that that got done as soon as possible. But we're looking at some options for the business area. So we sort of excluded that from the current project limits. So we're really looking to go from Route 46 up to about where the TD Bank is, a little bit past Condit, and that's where we're planning on ending it, right before the business area. The estimated cost for that project is around $400,000, and that includes milling and resurfacing the roadway, improving handicap ramps and bringing them up to code. It also includes some minor drainage improvements and curb repairs. Right now, it's a concrete curb roadway, and there are some areas that are in need of repair where they've either cracked or broken or chipped, settled out. So the original project was just to replace sections of the concrete curb where they were damaged and leave the rest as it is. I was asked to then look at what the cost would be to include new granite block curbs for the entire length of the project and what the cost would be. And in order to do that, we would have to then take the concrete curbs out and then replace them with the granite block curbs. And there'll be some minor adjustments at driveways and repairs at driveways that be included with that. And the cost for that is about $300,000 in addition to the estimated $400,000that we budget. So the total would be about $700,000 to do those improvements with new granite block curbs put in.
Mr. Lisa, the new concrete curbing that will be done, it will be done in sections. Not all of the curbing will be done from where the bank is on 46 to Condit Avenue. Is that correct?
That's correct. It will be spot repairs, 10 feet in one area, 20 feet, or as needed, just to make spot repairs to the areas that, like I said, are damaged or settled. But the rest of it will be left in place.
All right. Do we have any idea of the cost to replace all of the concrete curbing with concrete curbing?
I didn't do the estimate. Typically, if I compare granite block curb, and we usually pay for curbing on a linear foot basis, it's all subject to whoever the low bidder is and their prices, but typically we see concrete curb running anywhere between $20 and $22 a linear foot. Granite block curb is usually $2 to $3 more a linear foot. So that kind of gives you an idea where it might be.
Okay.
And this will be a little bit different where for the granite block curb, we're anticipating the price to be a little bit higher because we're pulling the old concrete curb out. So, you know, you may get another $3-4 a linear foot higher for the granite block curb just because of the removal and disposal of the existing concrete curb.
So, cosmetically, once you replace the sinking curbing or the curbing that's cracked or damaged in some sort, so now you're going to have this fresh-looking concrete compared to curbing that's been put back in there in the 60s then?
You will.
So it's not going to look really that desirable either for that area cosmetically.
Well, from an aesthetic standpoint, you're going to definitely see a difference between the new repaired areas and the old concrete.
Okay, and I know that I took a tour with you out there. How much curbing would you say is buckling or sinking? Because it seemed to me the other side of Beverick Road from where we were standing, it was either heaving or was dipping everywhere. For that curbing was put back in the 60s?
I don't know when it was put in, but there are some areas that have settled and, like I said, cracked. I don't have an estimate on that in front of me. We did go out there and try to get a gauge on what areas needed to have that replaced, so we have a budget item, but I don't have that, I'm sorry, in front of me.
So where Bank of America was just, you know, put in place, there's curbing around by that from 46 coming up, am I right?
That's correct.
And where does it stop at, the curbing for that?
The
So when it's coming off of 46, when it's coming back up Beverwick, because that's still part of Bank of America's property there, where does the curbing stop? Does it stop right before Hawkins, or is it?
They go right to the intersection. Yeah, because they're
not the bank intersection property. As it's coming back up Beverwick Road.
From 46 to Hawkins. Their property is the entire
That's right,
block.
Where they took the house down. Okay.
Right. They bought two lots and really made it one. So they have the entire block from 46 to Hawkins.
Okay. And then across the street there where the townhouses are, is that Belgian block or is that cement?
That's concrete as well.
That's concrete there. Okay. So it's not matching across the street then?
It matches currently.
Yeah, but you have Belgian block on one side and you have...
No, the bank put in concrete.
Oh, they put concrete
yes.
in? For some reason, I thought they put in Belgian block there.
No.
Okay. I know for the Waterview project, I know they're pushing for Belgian block. Waterview project? Okay. That's what it was. All right.
Justin, we talked about cosmetic differences, but I walked that same stretch and I seen there was a lot of disrepair in certain areas, and we have to piece it together, if you want to say, to repair the cement that's broken. What is the useful life of granite stone versus masonry? And keep it in consideration that masonry deteriorates by plows hitting it and also the salt as well.
To be honest with you, both of them hold up pretty much equally as well. There are a lot of factors that go into it, volume of traffic that's on the road, more so along the curb line, vehicles striking it. Plows do damage to both curbs, and surprisingly, there is a lot of damage to granite block curb. You just don't notice it as much just because it'll chip off and it's an angular look at it, so you don't see a lot of the damage on the
so
granite.
So future damage basically would be more hidden with the granite versus the concrete.
It's more hidden. You don't notice it as much. But as far as a life expectancy, they're both pretty much equal. And, you know, some roads you can get 70, 80, 90 years out of it, depending on the area and some of the other factors, environment. So.
Right. Also, one of my concerns cosmetically, as I agree with Councilman Flory, is the fact that, you know, this is a gateway and entrance that I believe in Lake Hiawatha over 23,000 cars pass by. So I'm going to go with the assumption that we have probably close to 30, maybe coming off of 46, that are using this roadway. So to have the most durable stone there and cosmetically pleasing stone that's safe would be something that I would be looking for. Would you agree that granite would meet the needs of that particular area as well?
I think it meets the needs of it from an aesthetic standpoint, but as far as structural stability, I think both serve the purpose just as well.
So we're looking at an additional $300,000 in the budget to use the granite stone, but as Councilwoman Grignani had mentioned, there's still a cost factor for the masonry, and we're looking at maybe a $3 difference per linear foot, would you say, somewhere around there?
No, that was the price with the... The price that you gave?
$300,000.
That correct. Was for the granite.
That was for removing the existing concrete and putting in new granite block.
Yes.
If we were to replace it with masonry, then there would still be an additional cost that could be close to that number.
If you wanted to remove all of the existing concrete curb and put back new concrete curb, it would be, you know, if it was $300,000 for granite block, you're probably in the $240,000 to $250,000 range, something along those.
But the $300,000 is to replace it with the granite block. Right.
That's correct. It's removing the existing concrete curb and putting in new granite block curb.
Okay, and this project, Ellen, we would bond for this, correct?
Yeah, this is a bonded project.
So, how much money would have to be put down for the bond for that?
It's just the 5%.
So we're talking about $15,000.
Yeah.
So $15,000, and the rest of that's going to be paid off over how many years?
It would probably be about 20.
Yeah,
okay.
20.
So not only the folks that are living there now, it's the residents that are going to be living there for years to come.
Right.
So I just look at, here's how I look at it. I mean, I lived in Lake Hiawatha for several years. I live on the lake. I live on the other side of town. And I just see certain developments that really look more, you know, more appealing looking because you do have that curbing. And I just see that, you know, that whole area of Beverwick Road and Lake Hiawatha. Lake Hiawatha just went through so much trauma based on the flooding down there. And I know the mayor wants to invest in doing the sidewalks over down there again and just really kind of beautifying that area of Lake Hiawatha beyond, you know, I know that area of when you're initially going is not Lake Hiawatha, but the curbing's going to run into Lake Hiawatha. I just think that it's long overdue for the folks that live on that side of town. And like Councilman Palouse had stated, it's really, it's the entrance into our theme of our downtown. Like, you know, Denville has their downtown area, but everybody brags about Ellen over there. I think that we should get our bragging rights in that part of the community, which in a lot of ways has been kind of, you know, left behind in some ways. And I think that we're trying to really clean up the area down there. I know we're cracking down on, you know, the vendors down there. And I just think that it would be just more grander of an entrance going into that side of the town. And if we're putting up only $15,000 into this budget, and it's going to be paid off over 20 years, council personnel, I think it's a good investment into the town, the infrastructure.
I completely agree with that. That's a good investment because, you know, it's the gateway to the community for our downtown area for Lake Hiawatha. We have a number of cars that are coming through. Creates added safety. It looks better. Cosmetically, I think it'll add value to the homes and the neighborhoods that are adjacent to that as well. So I would fully support spending the additional funds for that.
I just want to state, too, I know in my neighborhood they redid a lot of the curbing and they patched it up. And, you know, I mean, it does look, there's one street in my neighborhood where it's half new and half old because there wasn't any existing curbing there.
Right.
But because it already had concrete. And that is a main thoroughway into, you know, a very important part of our town. The thing that you brought up about financially, that it would be $15,000, and then you said it would take about 20 years to pay off. I mean, that concrete curbing, if you're saying they last about the same amount of time, I mean, that the concrete, I mean, granted, it is in disrepair right now, but it's so over 50 years old. It's only going to take 20 years to pay off. I mean, we're looking at, you know, it's paid off in 20 years, and then it lasts another 30, 40, 50 years after that. So, you know, I think that's something to consider.
And I think I would...
Grab that microphone.
And I know. I think Ann and I were just talking about it. We think with regard to the down payment money and what's in the capital improvement fund, we somewhat overstated it a little bit, so we're talking not $15,000, but we would have to modify the budget by about $3,000.
That's it, so, $3,000?
Yes, yeah, down payment money. Yeah. Okay.
You ladies are the best. $3,000. It's even better.
All right. We try to sharpen that pencil.
Thank you.
It's my turn.
Yes.
I disagree with everybody that's spoken here. I live in that section. I see that curbing every day. I estimate more than 90% of that curbing is in good sound condition. You're talking about less than 10% of that would have to be replaced or repaired. Much less than 10% in my estimate. So to replace 90% of curbing that's perfectly good, okay, just for aesthetics, at a price of $300,000, I disagree with.
Okay. How much would you say has to be replaced? Councilman DePiro says about 10%.
Again, I don't have those numbers in front of me, but he's probably not very far off.
The other question I have for you is, and he's bringing up a good point, Mr. DePiro, is that I know that the life expectancy of that road in Winchamilla is how long? About 7 years, 10 years?
Again, that's all dependent on volume of traffic, what type of traffic, you know, is
salt,
it cars, trucks, salt, how good the subbase is.
Okay.
It's not an easy thing. We've had roads that have lasted 40 years and are still in good shape, and some we've resurfaced in 10 years. So.
No, and all great points, but here's where I'm going beyond that is now you have curbing that lasted 50, 60 years. You all openly admitted it, and it could last longer. So the probability of probably more areas of that road, right, those curbs are either going to sink, they're going to heave, or whatever case may be. And I'm sure the folks that live over there are going to have their eye on it and say, hey, listen, this section is linear foot, needs to be replaced. So to me, it's going to wind up looking like you're in the Bronx here with different colors of concrete. And I just think that it's going to be even more unappealing. So I just want everybody to think about not just this moment, think about 3 or 4 years from now if we do have to replace other sections of, you know, linear curbing, and it's going to be a new coat of concrete, so you're going to have more discoloration, and it's not going to look appealing. And I think that we're all going to regret it.
I'm thinking about a $300,000 bond that we're going to be paying over 20 years, and most of it is not necessary.
Well, that's your opinion if you're thinking that's not necessary. I think the capital improvement, we did to the Knoll and we did to the Sword Tree Plan. I respect your opinion, but I think that there's, you know, you're doing good work for the town and good work for the infrastructure. So,
I have another question, Mr. Lisa. You mentioned that we're getting $245,000 from the NJDOT.
Correct.
But you did mention a $400,000 amount.
$400,000 is the estimated cost for the entire project. The grant is only covering a portion of the entire project.
Okay, so not only are we going to be having an additional $300,000, but we also have an additional $155,000.
That was in last year's capital.
That was in last
there.
Year, so last it's year's, already
yeah.
there.
Yes.
Money's
okay.
There.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Anybody else have any questions, concerns? Mayor or Ellen?
Not on this subject, but I received a late email from, and I wasn't in the office, which I normally am
I wasn't in the office to get Councilman Rob's email, but I did ask him to, oh God, Justin
Road.
Lisa, this microphone's making me, on Vail Road, you had a question on Vail Road, so I asked Justin to answer that with regard to Belgian Blood. Yeah.
The Vail Road project is the really, it's not a road improvement project. It's more a road stabilization project. That is for the area that is from Carlson going towards the Montville Bridge, where it keeps settling and washing out into the Rockaway River.
Yes.
So the project really is to stabilize the embankment along the river and create a better road surface. So there are no curbs proposed in that area. It will still drain off the roadway into the river as it does now. The project is really just for stabilization.
In the part of the stabilization, will you widen the road at all or remove any of the piping that's sticking out? Because there's a certain turn over there where it's very tight for cars passing and an extreme hump of mm-hmm. pipe that's sticking out of the ground. Will that be resolved?
We are removing that pipe. We are putting additional drainage in on that side of the road, and the road will be widened a maximum about 3 feet right in that area where it pinches down. Just because of the constraints with the river and embankment on the other side of the road, we couldn't go much further than that. But we were able to get about 3 feet, maybe 3.5 feet wider in that area. And it will be a noticeable improvement there.
Will there be a side area for people to walk? Because sometimes there is people walking and
because of the location of the river and the way that embankment comes up abruptly right from the edge of the roadway, there wasn't a lot of room within our right-of-way to put even a wall and to expand it. Plus, the DEP was really monitoring what we can and can't do there because it's in a floodplain.
Okay, but it's nice to hear that they were working on that part.
Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Just one quick question on the curbing on North Beverick Road with the grant. With the grant, Justin, I think we discussed it. That grant also includes the repairing of the curb, am I correct?
Well, when we applied for the grant, it was for all the proposed improvements. So it did include improving or repairs to the concrete curb. But again, that grant only covers a portion of the overall project.
Yeah. Thank you.
We just had the rest of the money from last year that's being applied to this.
That was budgeted in last year's capital.
Yeah. So we're fortunate that we budgeted wisely on that.
Very fortunate.
Very. Oh, thank
good,
you.
Good job.
Great. Is there any other questions or concerns? And I thank you for
thank you.
Being here.
Thank
you.
Oh,
first
you're
thank you.
Anytime.
Thank appreciate you. It. Thank
you.
Can
help. Have
Mr.
a good evening.
President.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Justin, and for short notice and coming out. We
Mr.
appreciate
President.
It.
Now you just continue with the order of the agenda.
Yeah, that's what I want to do before we go to the public section.
Yeah, under introduction, you then will decide which one you guys want to put up for a vote.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right,
after
that's where I was
public
going
portion.
To go. Yeah, so you have time to make your decision when we get to that ordinance, and our clerk will make sure that you know which one you're voting on and how it will be, so we have our game plan down here.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
All right, anything from the township attorney?
Good evening, Council President. No report tonight from the Township Attorney's Office.
Great, thank you. CFO, Ann?
Yes. I just have a small, any questions you have on the ordinances, of course. And I did leave with you detail of what we did put into the budget that's included in those ordinances. So this is a summary of the capital budget, okay, by item for you. And I just wanted to mention that I think we talked about tours at the sewer plant, and I was fortunate also enough to go on one of the plant tours with the insurance people to inspect and see the safety and everything, and it was really very interesting, quite frankly. And we have done a couple of tours, a plant tour from a science teacher, that's from Passaic Valley High School, and then one more from I want to say Morris County School of Technology. So we are having some tours.
All right, great, thank you. From the clerk's office?
No report, Mr. President.
Thank you. Any committee reports from the council members? Mr. DePiro?
No.
Mr. Peluso?
No.
Mr. Creefy?
No.
Mrs. Briani?
Yes.
Great.
I'd like to mention that last night we had the School Safety Shared Services kickoff program.
Yes.
Hosted by Ms. Sandman, and our mayor was there, and it's a great program, as we all know, and I believe I feel that the officers that will be at the junior high school, both at Central and Brooklawn, will do an excellent job, just as the officers have done at both of the high schools. You were there, Mr. Valori?
Yes.
So it was the mayor and Mr. DePiro. It was a very rewarding evening, and I think everyone will be very happy with the program as it goes forward next year, full steam ahead.
Absolutely. Thank you.
I do have one comment from our committee. I'm sorry, I forgot.
Okay.
The historical committee had a question. The question was in regards to asking the administration. They want to know why it's taking a long time for the conveyance of the wetlands and the lands that were conveyed to us for Forge Pond and the dam. They're asking why it's taking such a long time to accept the property that was given to us from the agreements for the 1990s, and how come we're accruing a lot of legal fees?
Well, the simple question is as you are aware, it's in litigation. So it's something that we won't be speaking to the historical committee until it's either settled or not. That's really all I can report on it.
Okay, I'll convey that to the committee. Thank you.
Okay, great. Anything else from the committee reports? Okay. Bits to be taken, 6/9/16, paper leaf bags. To be taken on 6/22, Edward Road Water Main Replacement, 6/29, 2/16 Roads Resurfacing Program, and July 6, Electrical Testing as Wastewater Treatment Plant. Okay, I'd like to entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
Motion.
Motion made by Mr. Carrifi, second by Mr. Peluso. Roll call.
Mr. Carrifi?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Peluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
The floor is open to the public.
Anybody from the public, please come forward. Please state your name. You have 5 minutes.
Should I sign in?
Yes.
Please.
Yes, you can sign in. Thank you, sir.
Sir, you dropped something, sir.
If you can move to the mic.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Mayor, members of the council. I have a small matter compared to what I've heard so far tonight to talk to you about. It involves one tree planted on June 7th in the town's right of way in front of my home.
And where's that located, sir?
Sedgefield, 6 Hastings Road.
Okay.
I'm going to just lower the mic for you a little bit.
What's his name?
There you go.
Thank you.
Can you state your name, sir?
Appreciate that.
Sir, can you please state your name for the record?
Okay.
Sir, may we have your name, please?
Bob. V-O-L-L, like in volleyball.
Okay.
Thank you.
So on June 7th, apparently there was a number of trees planted in Sedgefield, and I got one of them in front of my house. I got a purple plum, which was apparently the choice because it's a lower stature tree. It doesn't get up into the wires which run on that side of the street. That's a good choice of tree. But from my standpoint, even though it was maybe somebody's intention to do me a favor, it's a complete disfavor to me. That's the subject I would talk about tonight. And my purpose here is to try and get that tree removed. And you say, well, why? What kind of a nut is this? We give him a free tree in front of his house and he doesn't want it. Well, the story goes back to 1961 when we bought this property, 55 years ago.
Okay.
I've lived in that same house for all that time. When we bought the house, we bought the house without any landscaping, just mud and rocks. From there, I had to learn how to design landscapes, which I did. I learned from Rutgers, Cornell, and other places to use professional standards. So I designed the whole property. Landscaping, plantings, etc. The key to the front yard is to focus attention of the viewer at the curb to the middle of the house at the doorway, which means you're trying to create the maximum curb appeal. If you're going to have maximum curb appeal by your landscape design, well, you've also got to have maximum viewability from the curb. Anything that gets in the way of that reduces that that factor. So for 55 years, I've been successful in keeping that nice lawn open, total good view to the property, until somebody decided, I don't know who, to plop a tree in front of exactly where I don't want it. So I'm here to ask for the powers that be to remove it. One other point. Awards were given out tonight for various things. This is the award I received from the town of Parsippany in this room, 1987 November. First place winner of the landscape contest. Private and designed and maintained by the homeowner. Mayor Frank Fiore. So that kind of says the landscape is good.
Yes.
Based on two landscape architects who reviewed the property. When the tree was going to be planted, that's a complete surprise to me. On May 23rd, I woke up and saw a white patch of spray paint on the lawn, 5 feet in from the curb. What kind of a miscreant have we got in our neighborhood now? The next day, I saw a blue flag at the water shutoff and a blue W painted on the curb. Uh-oh. Now I knew what was going on. Parks and Forestry must have put the white paint 18-inch diameter. The water department's cooperating. They identified the water line. On the 25th of May, I called Town's Mayor's Action Committee. They didn't know anything about it. They referred me to the Parks and Forestry.
Okay.
I called, talked to Bob Stewart. He said he would get me to the right guy. He would call me. John Blaine.
You have about 1 minute, sir.
That was on the 25th of May. I never heard from him until after the tree was planted. He was saying, well, it wasn't his option. He's just following orders that the engineering department laid out. So I don't know who to chase to ask to get rid of the tree.
Okay.
But I'm asking this body to take care of it.
Okay, if, sir. This time was up, but we'll ask some questions now, sir.
If I may, I actually spoke with Mr. Vall. I stopped by his house. And I saw this, Ellen, this is the gentleman I was talking to you about. For one, they did take down a lot of trees in the neighborhood when they did the road work and the curbing and everything, but his house was not one of them. We have a resident here that adamantly stated, he left a sign out in front saying, I do not want the tree, please do not put a tree here. The town put it there anyway.
Okay.
I know he received that award in 1987. I'll bet you if the town had a contest right now, he'd probably win it again. The man's yard, every bush is trimmed perfectly. Everything is just, I mean, everybody would love to have a yard like his. I think it's really a shame that the town just went ahead against his wishes and just put a tree in, right in the center of his front lawn. And it does take away from all the work that he's done over the last 50, 60 years.
And it's only going to get worse as the tree grows. And more blocks view of the property.
Right.
I had one suggestion that perhaps if the tree could be removed, it could be perhaps planted in Grafton Park, which is perhaps up for renewal or improvement.
Okay.
And if worse comes to worse, if I can't get rid of it, perhaps I have to write a check to the town treasurer and say, please sell me your tree I'll plant it down in the park.
Okay.
I just would like to go on record that Councilman Karifi did call and leave a message with my administrative assistant. I did receive it, then I went to a seminar, and then Monday happened, and I didn't get a chance to get as much information as I would like. However, sitting next to the man next to me who's had more experience here in Parsippany, I'm going to turn it over to him for an answer. But again, that's not my normal, you know, I'm usually right on top of it, and I only got it. I got it after the tree was up, right? I mean, I'm innocent,
yeah, no,
right?
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, well, you showed it to me.
Yeah, we only, yeah.
Right.
So, all right, so I'm going to turn it over to the mayor. But I take responsibility if I can't get back to, not about the tree, just about not getting as much information. But I think the mayor just advised me that he has some information on it.
Well, first, before I get to you, sir, any council member that has an issue, Councilman Pelori, and I have to say Councilman Michael DePiro and Loretta Grignani, Councilwoman, they always contact me. So please feel free to contact me when you hear something like this, because I will respond to it immediately. You've never had a tree on your property, am I correct?
In the town right away?
Yes.
You're correct. I never had a tree there.
Because we do have a town ordinance that if they remove a tree, they will replace it with another tree by town ordinance. But since you've never had one there.
On the properties adjacent to mine, there was one tree removed.
That's fine, but as long as it wasn't on your property.
Correct.
All right. I will speak to the forester tomorrow, Parks and Forestry Director. I will ask him if we can remove it.
Jim Walsh.
All right. And yeah, Jimmy Walsh. I'll speak with him. I'll ask him. Since it wasn't there, I'll ask him to remove it. And because by ordinance, we do have ordinances in town that stay. I'll give an example. We've had sections in Lake Hiawatha where they beautified. We did the whole area, but they took the trees down. But they placed the trees back by ordinance. Because if we don't put trees back, then we lose trees. But since you've never had one on your property, then, you
know. On town property, there's never been one.
Right. If there's never one on your property, it becomes a different story. You can call my office. You can call my office tomorrow, and I'll have an answer for you.
Very good.
Thank you, sir.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, Mayor. I have to put Mr. DePiro on the spot. Mr. DePiro, how long have you been on the council for?
33 years.
So, over your 33 years, have you ever run into this problem?
I was there when they gave Mr. Volley that award.
That's what I was going to ask you. You had to be there, because I know you don't like the curb. So, what's your opinion about this? Does this happen anywhere else in the town?
Well, I've never heard of a situation like this where
this is a first.
Someone doesn't want a tree.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, I have to bring.
You know, I had a story.
I have to bring to Jimmy Walsh tomorrow a complaint. Someone that wants one.
Oh, okay. We'll give him that tree.
Remove it from his property. You all know. The person that wants it.
You all know Lenny Dio.
Yes.
Right. Okay. Well, Lenny had a tree come down.
Okay.
And he wanted it replaced.
Very good.
You know, the hurricane knocked it down or something.
Okay.
Damaged it, tilted it, whatever. Okay. But the township says, well, that's not in our right. That tree was not in our right of way. Well, the township was the one who planted it there. He didn't plant it.
Oh, I love
the
this.
The township
yeah.
did. Okay. They probably put it in the wrong spot, you know. So now the township says, that's not our responsibility. It's not our tree. He says it is. So here we go. We'll take,
so we'll take that tree. This is going to be great. Lemon. See, this is historical.
Problem solved. Yeah.
Great.
Two happy people.
Right? Thank
turn
you.
Turn lemons into lemonade.
That's it.
Well, tell Lenny it's a gift from you.
Thank you very much.
And so you said it's a plum. Sounds like a plum deal. Okay, we'll make a. We'll make. A
I'm
here all. I'm here all week.
This worked out.
Also, if anything needs to be done to that front section of your property,
I'll take care of it.
There you go.
He's very meticulous.
I have to tell. I'll tell you, you're not going to find a nicer yard. You are not going to find a nicer yard.
So, is it resolved? The tree will go.
We'll get all taken care of.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. DePiro. Also here. This is good. Thank you, sir. Anybody else from the public?
Good night, sir.
Take care. Is this about a tree?
I'll sign in later. Nick Komiak, Lake Hiawatha. Every time I come here to talk about something, I wind up talking about something else. 2011 and 2012 on Oneida, we had 4 or 5 trees that were taken down. They were never replaced. They took down a tree on my property. They said they'd put a Plum. They never got back to me. I never got back to them. But I think they need a stump grinder. So I think I had second thoughts because I have a small piece of property. I would love a plum tree, but I don't know what kind of what it would look like when they got through with the stump remover. But up the street from me, we had a little them little bungalow houses that made the neighborhood look beautiful, and they put this little McMansion up there, and there was at least four trees on that property. I think there were two sycamores. It made the neighborhood look good. One of the reasons that I was glad to live there, and you got that aesthetic appeal from the trees, but nobody ever came back to put any trees there, and it would make that part of Oneida, once if it's okay with the homeowner, I would think, but if there's an ordinance, somehow that got left in no man's land. Nobody ever came back.
The trees are on the town right away.
Yeah, they're on the right away. I have to agree with Mr. DiPiero. I hate to admit it. But when I think of aesthetic beauty, I think maybe the street, the view, the trees. Yeah, if people have nice landscape, flowers, but curbs and the difference between, are the streets clean? And is this project, are they going to repair the storm drains? You have them big storm drains all over the town or everywhere, and when the litter's on the street, it just washes in. It all gets eventually down to the rivers. So, you know, if they're going to do any work, they ought to consider things like that too. If you can get it in the package, but that entrance when you're coming into Lake Hiawatha, it seems aesthetically pleasing to me. I don't think anybody's even going to notice. I never noticed any degenerate, condition there. And then it stops at the business district. It almost seems like that's where it should begin, no? To have it a little more pleasing, you know? But North Beverwick's got problems with the ordinance. The mayor said he was going to do something.
We're working on it.
There's still a lot of, it's just, I don't see any excuse for anybody owning it. Business or 7-Eleven or any of that stuff, you can't clean your property before you start the day or end the day. That's,
we were actually discussing that last night.
Yeah, it's pathetic, really. It's gotten a lot better.
Absolutely, it's gotten better.
But compared to the way it was, I got a whole history picture of that. I just couldn't believe that it was. I thought Parsippany, like you guys said, was a high class town. I'll save this for the next time. Discovered some stuff about taxes, inherited taxes. You guys wouldn't believe the average CEO in a Fortune 500 company now makes 335 times more than a rank and file employee. $12.4 million to $36.9 for the average worker. And in inheritance taxes, if you're married and if you're rich, you can keep $10 million. You don't even have to pay taxes on it. And that's in 18, the inheritance tax is federal. They do take federal inheritance tax. But you could see the unequal playing field here. So last week we're talking about taxes and austerity and where are we going to cut. You guys should get on the ball and start advocating for a fairer tax system. I'll do a letter to the editor about it, but I was listening to a college economic professor talk about how the inequality has increased tremendously since the 1980s, and that's your tax problem. You don't need austerity, you need the courage to do what has to be done, and you guys should advocate to the higher level for that. And
never should take any inherited taxes. That's just my opinion.
What?
Not from anybody.
We have 30 seconds.
People complain when they say, "Oh, poor people are raking the system." So are rich people. You're born into money. That's an unequal. You don't. In other words, you don't work for it.
15 seconds.
I'll put a letter in. They don't pay for it. They don't pay. They inherit it.
All right, that'll be time. Anybody else from the public? Thank you, Nick. Nick, I always say you're never boring, though. You always have something good coming up here with.
There's something different.
Something different.
I live in a good town.
Thank you.
Good evening. Nancy Snyder, 226 North Beverwick Road. I'm speaking in support of the Belgian block replacement of the existing curbing, especially in light of the fact that you're digging up the roadway already for the paving. This stretch of roadway, as you know, is slated for repaving, as you heard, and I'm maybe reiterating a lot of what you already said. Because the roadway is in dilapidated condition, the township recognizes it, so is the curbing. In many cases, the curbing of the ground overrides the curbing. And while I recognize that the grant that you have received does not cover the project, including the curbing, it does not absolve the township officials from properly remediating this roadway, this long-ignored roadway, and the needs of this primary roadway that serves as solid and consistent support and is the critical pathway for not only just local transportation, but emergency first responders going to highways, going to local avenues where there are major accidents, either to the lake, from Lake Hiawatha or to the highways. Much like the paving replacement of this curb is vital to the township's drainage system along its major thoroughfare, during times of winter months, the curbing needs to be sufficient enough to withstand the welcome plowing that it endures year after year after year. The current aging, crumbling, bowing, lots of bowing on this, in these curbings. I think Council President Roy, you've even witnessed some of it, the bowing. And of course, as I said, the ground that overtakes the curbing. Missing curbing, and an asphalt substitute curbing near 62 North Beverwick Road, is unable to adequately stand 20 to 30 years of more heavy-duty snowplows, accidents, off-the-roadway incidents. I sent to the administration recent photos reflecting the poor drainage and dangerous ice buildups that occur, even this past winter, where we had a relatively mild winter, except for a 30-plus-inch snowstorm. We had winter along the storm. Over the 8 years, Town Hall, the police department, the school district, has been presented with more than enough evidence, documentation, photographic evidence, police reports of tree damage, police reports of off-the-road incidents, snapped utility poles, scores of vehicular mishaps, speeding episodes, again, where drivers just jump the curbing, all along North Beverwick Road. And if you don't have it, just go to the police department, they have it. Now, admittedly, curbing cannot stop every accident. We all know that. However, we need substantial curbing. Aesthetically, this type of curbing is necessary. North Beverwick serves as a gateway to the business district, as you heard, to Lake Hiawatha, to the Wickliffe section of our town. It hosts homes where property owners are paying five-figure property taxes going up, and is now the host of the Bank of America. This is only increasing the traffic flow. So why don't we just like we replace curbing for Vela, I understand that that's not Belgian block. However, tertiary roadways have been given Belgian block, and this town has paid for it. Little traveled tertiary roadways. So what's good enough for little traveled tertiary roadways is good enough for North Berwick. To just do the concrete patchwork as suggested, it's going to be an eyesore prelude to our business district, to the Wickland section of the township, and just, you know, a bad reflection on the township itself.
1 minute.
Thank you. So I respectfully implore the mayor's office and the council to really, and everyone involved with this project, to get it right the first time. You're digging up the roadway. Do it right. Because what I forecast, you won't do it. And then you're just going to have to do it prematurely and ruin your paving project prematurely. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else from the public?
Pat Patacha, 182 Hawkins Avenue. Quickly, I'll ask just to be on Ordinance 2016-13, just where the property is exactly. I can't go by lots and stuff. Give me some kind of an idea. 2016-17, are we using the surplus money, for the sewer stuff? As far as this North Beverwick Road improvement, get it right the first time. We have major, serious problems on North Beverwick, especially Hawkins and Wall Avenue. We are constantly dodging cars coming up over the fire lane. Nobody realizes that Hawkins Avenue is one lane until you bypass North Beverwick is one lane until you bypass Hawkins. That's when the fire lane starts. Mother's Day, I'm sorry. I was leaving for Long Island, and I almost got hit three times. I sat there and waited and watched these cars just coming, and they're like, you're beeping at them, and they're like, hey, how you doing? Okay, we have serious problems out there. We've had serious accidents up there. That really needs to be looked at. If it's curbing versus people's lives, that's where I want the money. I love the curbing, but you need to look at that. All right, now I'm going to go back to something that's very old, and I'm asking you to just to listen, take down these questions, and please reply. The James Carrefi case started back in 2013. We had a township hearing officer, Mr. Devine, advise the township to dismiss administrative charges against Mr. James Carrefi. Chief Phillips, and I was witness to this, I was at this trial, in front of a judge advised Mr. Carrefi had retired in good standing. There were no administrative charges against him. Town Council created two resolutions, and yet nothing has been done. At the time that Mr. Devine's response was received, Mayor Barbario had advised the council and the public that he planned on sending another letter to Mr. Devine because he did not agree with Mr. Devine's conclusions. Did Mayor Barbaro ever send that letter to Mr. Devine? Did Mr. Devine respond to the mayor's concerns? Was the council ever informed of any letters being sent or received? If not, why not? You should be following up on this. Taxpayers' money are hanging. We're in the balance here. I mean, you are costing us so much money. How much has been spent on all the legal fees? Again, basically, what's the status under the Devine ruling? Where has it gone? Why hasn't Mr. Carrefi been paid? I think we all need to have answers to these questions. And I would appreciate it if we can get some answers here tonight.
All right, Pat, you're all done asking questions? Because you had about a minute and a half left.
Save it.
Unfortunately, I can't bank it, but you're done asking questions.
Okay.
Pat, can you please, sign in?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I can answer the question about the sewer, Pat.
Yes.
We're actually paying cash for that. There is no bond, so it is coming.
Hey,
yeah.
Thank you.
Khalid, I did not bring my copy of that ordinance, so can you just advise Mrs. Patatia what the answer is to the question? Which was it? Was it 13?
Yes.
13?
Yes.
Can you look at the body of it to tell her what property that is? Because the blocking lots don't help, and on that one, because I didn't bring my other folder.
Ellen, you're surprising me tonight.
You don't know the half of what got done.
I'll give it to you if you guys just continue. I'll give
okay.
it to you.
Okay. Thank you.
No problem.
Any of the other ones?
Any other questions from the public? You may come forward.
I'm sorry, Council President. I just have a question for Ann, our CFO. And you had just mentioned that it's cash, we're paying as we go for the sewer. Is that correct?
Yes.
On ordinance 2016-17, aren't we appropriating $1,087,000 for sewer utility capital improvements?
Yes. Paying cash for it.
And we are paying cash for it, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. Okay.
And the same for the water.
That's the validity of what we're talking about. That's
good. Very good. Okay. I just wanted to confirm that for the audience. Thank you.
And I know you did ask Ann, but, you know, I made a commitment a long time ago, a year ago, when we talked about this to you, and we did follow through on that. And we're saying also, as you heard from some of the budget information that we talked about, that Ann and I are going to review, because the time just got away. But before the end of the year, there's going to be some reduction in the authorization to spend out of that out of the sewer capital. And, you know,
what are you doing there with the bond, with the band?
With, yes.
With the
note sale, going into a bond sale, but we're going to reduce what the authorization, because those purposes are no longer required.
Hi, Katie Cassidy, 7 Stephen Terrace. I just want to reiterate what everybody's been saying about the Belgium blocks. I really think it makes a huge difference. I also think if you're going piecemeal, you're going to see it. It's a potential to really make it look a lot better. I would also recommend that before laying the road work down, once you've milled it up, check to see if there's anything that needs to be done with the plumbing, because I know on Vale Road, you repaved the road, and then we needed to get under, and then there's like strips, and then you're dodging this, that, and the other thing. So just check to make sure that there's nothing subterranean that needs to be addressed. While you're doing this, you can kill two birds with one stone and keep everything looking really nice that way. There's a common issue that I see coming up, one with the woman who had a property over on Fox Hill Road, and again with this nice gentleman who has great landscaping, that there's stuff going on in people's neighborhoods without them knowing what's happening. There's no notification from the township. They don't understand the trees are coming up. They don't understand that the trees are going back, or maybe it's not, they're not noting where the trees are accurately enough to put them back in the right space. There's spray paint going around, and then you know, is something going to come in here? You have no idea what's going on. I feel like it's not too much to ask that if there's going to be a project done in a neighborhood, that the citizens there are notified about what's going on. That's it for tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. No other questions?
No, that's it.
Okay, you're
thank
surprising
you.
Me.
Most of the times, when streets are being done, there's a letter that is sent out to the neighborhood. I sign it, so I know it goes to the neighbors. Maybe some just don't open up the mail or get it. I don't know. But anytime we do any type of construction projects, I send a letter out from the engineer department letting the residents know what's going to happen in the future.
Thank you, Mayor.
Council President, I'd like to reprieve myself.
Yes.
I did come up with the Ordinance 13. It has to do with
You're the best.
I try. This is what we're talking about is the lease agreement on the placing the antenna. That's what this one is? Yeah, the antenna. And this is something that we will be receiving money for. So that's what that is. Okay. That was a little bit of a long time in coming, but we worked it out to everybody's satisfaction. So, again, I apologize for my non-quickness, but I think I'm doing as best I can.
Thank you, Ellen.
Thank you.
I see no one else is going forward. I'd like to entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Make a motion.
Second, Bagnani.
Motion made by Mr. Cruffy, second by Ms. Grignani. Roll call.
Mr. Cruffy?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Peluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes. I'd just like to make mention on with this ordinance that we're going to try to either put forward, that it needs exactly what, 4 votes?
Yes.
For this ordinance to be approved. So do you want to elaborate on that a little bit?
Yeah,
so
because the 2016-16 ordinance under introduction B1 is a bond ordinance. A bond ordinance require what's called a supermajority, which would mean out of the council here, it's not the normal 3 votes. It would require 4 votes. If you don't get 4 votes, it will not pass. We also do have a couple other ordinances, and I will mention them as we come along, that will require 4 votes tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you. All right, Mike, we'll move forward. We'll start with Ordinance 216:13.
Ordinance number 2016:13, an ordinance of the Township of Parsippany, Troy Hills, County of Morris, State of New Jersey, repealing ordinances 90:31 and 99:18, and authorizing the sale of leasehold interest in and to Block 498, Lot 23, Block 136, Lot 65, Block 15.08, Lot 35.01, and Block 736.01, Lot 3, and changing the minimum bid structure thereof. Notice of the ordinance above was published in a Daily Record, the official newspaper of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills, on May 31st, 2016. This ordinance was carried from the May 24th, 2016 regular meeting. Motion to accept this ordinance.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. DePiro, second by Mr. Paluso. Roll call.
Mr. Griffey?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes. I'd like to open up, motion to open up the public hearing of ordinance.
Make a motion.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Griffey, second by Mr. DePiro. Roll call.
Mr. Griffey?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes. I see no one comes forward. I'd like to close the public hearing.
So
for this ordinance.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Paluso, second by Mr. Griffey. Roll call.
Mr. Griffey?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
Whereas the above ordinance was read in title on second reading and the hearing held thereon, now therefore be it resolved that said ordinance be passed on final reading, and that a notice of final passage of said ordinance be published in the newspaper according to law. Motion to approve the resolution.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. DePiro, second by Mr. Paluso. Roll call.
Ms. Griffey?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes. Great. Khalid, in regards to moving forward with the other two ordinances, how do you want us to handle with these two? Because I know you have two separate ordinances. One will be forward, and one will be obviously.
Well, you have the two ordinances. I'll let the CFO elaborate to explain which out of the 2016-16 ordinances applies to what, and then you guys can pick which one you guys want to put up for a vote.
Yes, we have the two ordinances. One includes the block curbing, and the first one, 2016-16, does not include the curbing. And then the $300,000 was added to the 2016-16 on number two. Right there. So depending on which you would like to, I assume you want to have a discussion. And
what we can do is we can vote on both of them, actually. We can do that. We can go through each one and vote on both of them. And if you guys want to open the floor for discussion, you can discuss.
No.
That's right.
No. That's no. What you need to do is you need to discuss the vote of inclusion or not, and then talk about the ordinance. Have the discussion. Call the vote for inclusion or not, and then the appropriate ordinance would be come up next. Have a discussion.
We'll make a motion to include it.
All right. I'll
second. I have a question before we do that.
Excuse me. I have a question too. Yes, go.
If I could just interject, whichever ordinance you choose to adopt, if you can then move to table the other ordinance, the one that you're not adopting.
Okay.
My question is, if someone has voted against introduction of the township budget, can they now vote to increase the budget that they're going to vote against?
Good question. I'm not quite sure who's the technical guru. That's why I have an attorney.
I'm asking the township attorney.
Yes.
Put him on the spot.
I apologize. I'd have to look into that and get back to the council on that.
Okay.
We did ask that question of the attorney, and it said, and the answer is yes.
Well, there you go.
Okay. So, real quickly, so there's no confusion, the first ordinance, Mike, that we were going to introduce here, that has the increase or doesn't have the increase?
No, it does not.
It does not have the increase. Oh, number two does. Okay.
That's the one I made the motion to introduce.
And I second already.
So oh, that's what you...
We have a motion on the floor.
Right? Okay, so you have a motion on the floor already?
We have a roll call.
Oh, okay. All right, so do you want to go into any discussion before we go into roll call here?
I think it's cleaner if you have the discussion and then you say you introduce the ordinance that reflects in or out.
Yeah, because I think what the BA is saying is if you vote no on this one,
yes.
First one, you can't go back.
I was going to say that, absolutely,
have
yeah.
A discussion
yeah.
And then it
all right.
becomes clear.
Well, we should vote on the second one first. That's the one that includes the extra money.
There's already a motion on the floor for it, so you want
right? to, well, you want to vote for the one that includes the extra money, because then you can't go back to the other one. So we should do that one first.
But do you want to have some dialogue before we go? I will hold on to the motion, but do you want to have some dialogue before we go into roll call on it and go into a vote?
I think we already had the
motion. Okay, so everybody's comfortable with that? All right, I just want to make sure no one's going to be upset. And I just want to make sure that the public understands that you need four approvals for it to pass. If not, like, you know, the clerk had said it, you need the supermajority here. Okay.
I just want to just also go on, not to belabor the point. When we were dealing with the budget, the capital budget, as well as the operating budget, we did move rather quickly on it. Council President, and I want to give you not credit in the sense of I had called and I brought this topic up and said we need to have,
yes,
you need to have dialogue on it. Now, in out of respect for the Council President and for transparency, I just want to say I thought maybe we could have just had a a straw vote, and a Council President said no, I would prefer, and I think that was the better way to go.
Absolutely.
Prefer to have it open in the public, have the discussion, and Councilwoman Grignani, in speaking with our CFO, said perhaps if we had our engineer out, and as I said, late notice, and he did come out. So as an administrator for many years, I'd like to say respectfully, this council and mayor are doing their due diligence, and we're trying to get as much information out that the finance lady and the administrator have. We're the gonging bells sometimes, and sometimes we need to have the engineer come out and clarify what we're talking about and what the monies are. So again, I just want to compliment the council on making whatever decision they make is a decision that was a thought out decision. So
absolutely,
I just want to say that.
I just want to say for the record, however the vote goes down, I respect everyone's opinion and decision here. There's folks here with a lot of experience here, and I just, again, for the record, I just believe that this will be an improvement to the infrastructure, and I would hope someday that the town keeps improving all its different, sections and parts of the town that are main thoroughfares, or even, you know, the off-roads. Because I lived back on Wingate in Crestview, and actually I lived next door to Mr. DePiro's daughter at the time, probably about 15 plus years ago, and we fought for the curbing in that section of town because the drainage was horrible, there was no curbing, and the town, you know, we came and we actually did a caucus of the neighborhood, we went to the town council, I don't know if Mr. DePiro, yeah, Mr. DePiro, you were on the council at the time, and Jamie, I don't think you were on the council at the time.
No,
and Mr. Taylor and yeah, I know, but we did actually successfully succeed, and we were able to get curbing for actually Wingate Road in Crestview, which is right off of 202 there, you know, before St. Christopher's, and that development looks beautiful, and the drainage was a success. So I thought that was something that was always a vision for the town, just to keep improving. But if anybody votes no against this, there's no hard feelings.
We not only gave you curbing, we gave you a park in that neighborhood.
Yeah, you did give us a park in that neighborhood. Actually, you did. You've been around a long time. And that's a great park. That park still looks great today with the volleyball back there, too. Great development back there. So needless to say, I do respect everybody's decision or their opinion. So I just want to at least let you know where I stand. And again, I'm just hoping that we could keep improving the infrastructure of the town. That's all.
I have a question. Ms. Sandman, the bond, does it have to be for 20 years? I know that's the life of a road bond.
No, and is, but she's letting me shine for my certification as a finance officer. And remember, for a little while when I first came, I was also the finance director. And I'll turn it over to.
I love those two down there.
I know. It's a long day. It gets a little punchy, and we had a long day yesterday. What was your question? No, I know. I'm kidding. The thing is, in the public contract law, there's a litany of things, sidewalks, vehicles, apparatus, that have useful life. Basically, when you put a bond ordinance in together, all these useful lives go together. Like this has a 10-year useful life. This can have a 20-year useful life. If your question basically is, we could pay it off sooner, in a sense, yes. The ordinance will have we have a useful life of an average, averaging it out, and you know, then when you sell the bonds, you can sell them for a 30-year bond ordinance or a 25-year bond ordinance. But remember, we're also going to be investigating certain funded portions that we may be able to pay down some debt, yeah, too. So in answer to your question, literally it doesn't have to be 20, but it's a blend, so it's more of there's more involved in it. But I think I'm anticipating you're saying, is there a way we could pay something off sooner?
Yes.
That's what you're asking. Oh, you want to add to that?
Thank you.
You always entertain me down there. Thank you. Okay, since we do have a motion on the floor by Mr. Creefy and it was seconded by Mr. Paluso.
Now, this motion is for the 2016 number, the second one, correct?
Correct. Yes.
Okay, so what we'll simply do is you cannot do a motion to table for the first one because that simply means we'll have to put it back on the next agenda. So we just exclude it altogether and you just move on depending on what the vote is.
Great. Yes. Okay. That's, I'm so glad we have a clerk that's an attorney. Thank you. Great.
I'm sorry.
All right, so I had the motion by Mr. Creefy, seconded by Mr. Paluso. Roll call.
Mr. Creefy?
Yes.
Mr. DePiero?
You know, we didn't read the ordinance.
Yes.
We got to read it.
We got to read it. You're going to read it, right?
Okay.
Yeah, let's just do that.
Okay, so I had Mr. Paluso. Yes, read it. Sorry about that.
The ordinance 2016:16. This is the second ordinance. An ordinance of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills in the County of Morris, New Jersey, providing various capital improvements for the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills and appropriating $9,958,592. Therefore, including a grant in the amount of $245,000 from NJOT and providing for the issuance of $9,104,412 in general improvement bonds or notes of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills to finance part of the cost thereof. Be it resolved that the above ordinance be introduced, read in title, and passed on first reading at a meeting of the Township Council of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills held on June 21st, 2016, and that said ordinance be further considered for second reading and final passage at a meeting to be held on July 19, 2016 at 7:30 p.m., prevailing time or as soon thereafter as the matter may be reached at the municipal building in said township, at which time all persons interested shall be given an opportunity to be heard concerning said ordinance. Be it further resolved that the clerk be authorized and directed to advertise said ordinance with the notice of introduction thereof being published in the official newspaper according to law. Motion to approve the above resolution.
Second. Motion made by Mr. Paluso, seconded by Mr. Griffey. Roll call.
Ms. Griffey?
Yes.
Mr. DePiero?
No.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Okay. Mrs. Grignani,
ordinance, page 5. Ordinance 2016:17. An ordinance of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills in the County of Morris, New Jersey, appropriating $1,087,000 for various sewer utility capital improvements. Be it resolved that the above ordinance be introduced, read by title, and passed on first reading at the meeting of the Township Council of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills held on June 21st, 2016, and that said ordinance be further considered for second reading and final passage at a meeting to be held on July 19th, 2016 at 7:30 p.m., prevailing time or as soon thereafter as the matter may be reached at the municipal building in said township, at which time all persons interested shall be given an opportunity to be heard concerning said ordinance. Be it further resolved that the clerk be authorized and directed to advertise said ordinance with the notice of introduction thereof being published in the official newspaper according to law. Motion to approve.
Second. Motion made by Mrs. Grignani, seconded by Mr. Creefy. Roll call.
Mr. Creefy?
Yes.
Mr. DePiero?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Paul?
Ordinance 2016:18, an ordinance of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills in the County of Morris, New Jersey, appropriating $170,000 for various water utility capital improvements. Be it resolved that the above ordinance be introduced, read by title, and passed on first reading at a meeting of the Township Council of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills held on June 21st, 2016, and that said ordinance be further considered for second reading and final passage at a meeting to be held on July 19th, 2016. 7:30 p.m. prevailing time or as soon thereafter as the matter may be reached at the municipal building in said township, at which time all persons interested shall be given an opportunity to be heard concerning said ordinance. Be it further resolved that the clerk be authorized and directed to advertise said ordinance with the notice of introduction thereof being published in the official newspaper according to law. Motion to approve the above resolution by myself.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Creffy, second by Mr. Paluso. Roll call.
Ms. Creffy?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Mr. DePiro?
Ordinance 2016:19, an ordinance of the Township of Parsippany Trails in the County of Morris, New Jersey, providing for golf course and recreation utility improvements in and for the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills and appropriating $119,177 therefore, and providing for the issuance of $113,218 in bonds or notes of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills to finance part of the cost thereof. Be it resolved that the above ordinance be introduced, read by title, and passed on first reading at a meeting of the Township Council of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills held on June 21st, 2016, and that said ordinance be further considered for a second reading and final passage at a meeting to be held on July 19, 2016 at 7:30 p.m. prevailing time or soon thereafter, as the matter may be reached at the municipal building in said township, at which time all persons interested shall be given an opportunity to be heard concerning said ordinance. Be it further resolved that the clerk be authorized and directed to advertise said ordinance with the notice of introduction thereof being published in the official newspaper according to law. Motion to approve the above resolution.
Second, Grignani.
Motion made by Mr. DePiro, second by Mrs. Grignani. Roll call.
This is a bond ordinance, so it will also require four votes. Mr. Creffy?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Mr. Paluso?
Non-consent agenda. Resolutions. Resolution 2016-127, resolution of the Township Council of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills, certifying volunteer first aid, rescue and recovery, and ambulance squads as being qualified for emergency medical service programs. Motion to approve the above resolution.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Paluso, second by Mr. DePiro. Roll call.
Ms. Creffy?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Great.
Resolution 2016-128, resolution of the Township Council of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills approving a fireworks display. Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Grignani, second by Mr. Creffy. Roll call.
Ms. Creffy?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Just for clarification, 128 is for the county fireworks.
Yes.
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 That is correct.
Yes. 129 is for the township fireworks. Now, this is 128. I vote yes.
Okay. Mr. Creffy? This is roll call, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So, Mr. Creffy?
Yes.
Your turn.
Mr. DePiro?
Said yes.
Oh, he said yes. Oh, he threw me off with the comments. Sorry. Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Here. Okay, Mr. Creffy.
Okay, resolution 2016-129, resolution of the Township Council of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills approving fireworks display.
Second, Grignani.
Motion made by Mr. Creffy, second by Mr. Grignani. Roll call.
Ms. Creffy?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Paluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes. Mike?
Resolution 2016-125, resolution of the Township Council of the Township of Parsippany Troy Hills appointing a risk management / liability insurance broker of record services to Fairview Insurance Agency Associates, Inc. for a fee of 7% of the municipal assessment. Motion
Second.
To approve the above resolution.
Second, Grignani.
Motion made by Mr. DePiro, second by Mrs. Grignani. Roll call.
Ms. Creffy.
Before we vote, now, Alan or Ann, you guys said, now, explain that real quick. You said we're not paying for this or something like that? This 7%?
Oh, okay.
Garden State.
And that's
it's paid by Garden State, not us.
That's why I, on this one, although I didn't get any additional information, I did make sure that prior to this meeting, you got all the information and all the savings that were generated by this. But yes, the correction is this is paid through the joint insurance fund.
No,
this 7% is a standard bear all risk managers that are in it, and it's in that long pay. First, right up at the top, that this is what each risk manager,
everyone gets.
Everyone is, that's the standard it's not more, it's the standard number.
No, I just wanted that on the record.
I have an additional question. Can you tell me if there was a fair and open bidding process done on this? And was there options for other companies?
This is professional, and I don't believe we have to go out for fair and open bid. I don't.
So you don't have to, but you could, but you didn't.
I don't know how to answer that.
Not for professional service contracts.
Yeah.
You don't have to.
You don't have to.
Yeah, but if you want to, you could.
With anything.
With anything. There's options of other companies.
But what you stated earlier, though, if there was another company, they would have still gotten 7% anyway.
Correct.
Over the years, with regard to the creation of the joint insurance funds, back in 1986, Morris County became the third joint insurance fund. In January 1 of 1987, we began, and some towns had risk managers. And one of the things, because I was on this risk management, I was involved with coverage for 20 of my 27 years on the joint insurance fund, it became apparent that there was a need to make sure that there was some continuity with regard to what each municipality was paying to their risk managers. And it was voted upon by these commissioners who come from the town that a standard number would be acceptable. A town could pay more, but in most cases they came to with terms. I have not been a member until I came here for Garden State, but they do follow the same guidelines. So that's my understanding of how it. And Anne has been more longer time as a member, and she can state that that's how that was voted upon.
Okay. So therefore, there wouldn't be any open or any kind of bid process because they all get paid the same.
But just to follow up, under the local public contract law, professional services is an express exemption to open bidding. So, I mean, it would be unusual to do that.
But we do have an option to pick multiple companies, though.
But they're still, aren't they? But they're all getting the same.
Okay,
percentage.
I'll answer the question. But we didn't. We chose Fairview. And so that's what you got to
okay,
vote on.
That's
tonight.
The only answer I want. Thank you very much.
Are we in the middle of the vote?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
So, Mr. Cariffi had
yes.
voted. Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Peluso?
No.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
4-1, the motion passes.
Mr. Peluso?
Consent agenda, be it resolved that all items listed with an asterisk are considered to be routine and non-controversial by the Township Council and will be approved by one motion. There will be no separate discussion of all these items unless a council member so requests, in which case an item be removed from the consent agenda and considered in its normal sequence on the agenda. Motion to approve the consent agenda.
Second. Motion made by Mr. Peluso, seconded by Mr. Cariffi. Roll call.
Ms. Cariffi?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro? Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Peluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
Motion passes.
For the applications, you have resolution.
Mr. Valori, that's actually, I apologize, that may be a little confusing, but that's also under the consent agenda, so that automatically goes with the consent.
Exactly, great. So I'm glad that there's no confusion there. Thank you. I'd like to make a motion to adjourn the meeting.
Make a motion.
Second, Grignani.
Motion made by Mr. Cariffi, second by Mrs. Grignani. Roll call.
Mr. Cariffi?
Yes.
Mr. DePiro?
Yes.
Ms. Grignani? Ms. Grignani?
Yes.
Mr. Peluso?
Yes.
Mr. Valori?
Yes.
We're adjourned.
Thank you, everyone, tonight, and I appreciate the audience. Thank you for coming tonight, and I appreciate the input. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Is it hot here or is it me?
It's a little warm.
Yeah,
it's a little warm.
It's
a little warm.
It's certainly not the air conditioning.
Absolutely.
Bill, for that extra $300.